Conquistador, Hernán Cortes, King Montezuma, and the Last Stand of the Aztecs, by Buddy Levy. Narrated by Patrick Lawlor. Copyright 2008 by Buddy Levy. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Bantam Dell, a division of Random House Incorporated, and was produced in the year 2008 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Introduction. In 1519, an ambitious and calculating conquistador named Hernan Cortes sailed from Cuba and arrived on the shores of Mexico with empire expansion in his veins. He intended to appropriate the newfound lands in the name of the Crown of Spain, to convert the inhabitants to Catholicism, and to plunder the rich lands of their precious metals, namely gold. Cortes made land at Pontonchan, a considerable native fishing settlement, with a roguish, roughshod crew containing 30 crossbowmen, 12 men with muzzle-loading handguns called harquebuses, 14 pieces of small artillery, and a few cannons. Carefully, methodically, Cortes and his crew used ropes and pulleys to unload 16 Spanish horses, highly trained and skilled war horses, of which the indigenous Americans had no concept or understanding, never having seen any. He also unloaded savage and well-trained war dogs, mastiffs and wolfhounds. In addition to his band of Spanish pirates and mercenaries, Cortes brought along a few hundred West African and Cuban slaves for use as porters. It was March 1519. Cortes marched his small force over massive mountains and active volcanoes towering 18,000 feet high, straight into the Valley of Mexico and the very heart of the Aztec civilization. What Cortes encountered when he arrived at Tenochtitlán, the famous City of Dreams, were not the barbarians that his conquistador predecessors had envisioned, but a powerful and highly evolved civilization at its zenith. The Aztecs possessed elaborate and accurate calendars, efficient irrigation systems for their myriad year-round crops, zoos and botanical gardens unrivaled in Europe, immaculate city streets with waste management methods, astounding arts and jewelry, state-run education, sport in the form of a life-or-death ball game, a devoted and organized military apparatus, and a vast trade and tribute network stretching the entirety of their immense empire as far south as Guatemala. Cortes and his Christian brethren would soon discover that the Aztecs also possessed a highly evolved and ritualized religion, much more complex than their own, a religion that its people followed with equal, if not greater, faith and conviction. Instead of one god, they zealously worshipped a pantheon of deities in elaborate and sophisticated ceremonies. At Tenochtitlan, at the time among the most populated and vital cities on earth, much larger than Paris or Peking, Cortes finally confronted Montezuma, the charismatic and enigmatic Aztec ruler. Their first meeting could be considered the birth of modern history. The conflict that followed was a religious one, ultimately, pitting the monotheistic Catholicism of the Spaniards against the polytheistic mysticism of the Aztecs. And though in many respects the two empires were vastly different, they were actually parallel in a number of striking ways. Both were barbaric in their unique traditions. The Spaniards, fired and forged by the Crusades, would pillage and rape and kill in the name of God and country, subsuming indigenous cultures with little respect for their centuries of existence. The Aztecs used military force and violence to subjugate independent neighboring tribes and performed rites of human sacrifice and cannibalism. Neither could comprehend the other, and neither was willing to acquiesce. Both were uncompromisingly devoted to expanding their already considerable empires, and each was under the guidance and tutelage of a great leader. The most significant of all the conquistadors, Hernán Cortes was a late bloomer, arriving in the New World in 1504. He lived in relative anonymity for over a decade before asserting himself in the political scene of the West Indies colonies, by which time he was in his early 30s. Born in 1485 in Mathelin, Spain, site of castles and strongholds used in the last efforts of the Reconquista, the expulsion of the Moors after 700 years of occupation, Hernan was the son of Martin Cortes, a low-level hidalgo, not overly distinguished or well-bred, and Doña Catalina Pizarro Altimirano. A frail and sickly child, Cortes began university at age 14 in Salamanca, but returned home bored and distracted after only 2 years. His mind must have been quick and perceptive, however, because his erudition in diplomacy and politics would surface later, serving him well. He studied government, law, and Latin, and would later be described by his secretary, Francisco López de Gomara, as restless, haughty, mischievous, and given to quarreling. Wanderlust filled his heart early on, and in 1503 he was set to join an expedition to the West Indies with Don Nicolas de Ovando. On the eve of his departure, the young rake Cortes was injured, leaping to escape when caught in the house of a married woman. His injury cost him a chance on that ship, and he spent the next year carousing in Spain's rough southern port villages. In 1504, the impetuous young man had earned entry onto one of 5 merchant ships setting sail for Santo Domingo, the bustling capital of Hispaniola and first settlement of the New World. Cortes had, for a few years now, heard rumors of untold wealth to be garnered in unknown lands, where gold flowed like water from the mysterious mountains. Just 19 and with an adventurer's spirit, having learned to ride as a youth while herding swine, and gleaned the rudiments of cavalry tactics in school and from his father, as well as from the widely popular romances, Hernán Cortes was entirely anonymous and average as he booked passage to the West Indies. He had no way of knowing that in less than 2 decades he would command a Spanish force in one of the greatest assaults in military history and become among the most revered and reviled men in all the world. Cortes's rival had led the Aztec people for nearly 2 decades. The ruler of the Aztec Empire, Montezuma, was born in 1480, just 5 years before Hernán Cortes. Sometimes also referred to as Montezuma II, he was trained as a priest and rose to become the military, spiritual, and civic leader of the Aztecs in 1503, just as Cortes was on the verge of arriving in the West Indies. At that time, the Aztecs controlled most of what is now Mexico and Central America, their capital being the great city of Tenochtitlán, present-day Mexico City. Montezuma was enthroned as the Tlaltoani, Great Speaker, at the great temple built by his own brothers, and his coronation involved an elaborate ritual of bloodletting, self-piercing with bone slivers, the decapitation of 2 quails, and the spraying of their blood on an altar flame. Moody, petulant, even tyrannical, Montezuma was zealously driven by his spiritual beliefs. He was the semi-divine ruler of a devout people whose supreme being was the sun, and whose highly stylized and symbolic religion was driven by seasonal festivals, feasts, and celebrations observed by all members of society. The Aztec religion was an amalgamation of ancient Mesoamerican rites and traditions centered on paying tribute and making offerings to the many gods who orchestrated human destiny. The Aztecs believed these offerings, incense, birds, flowers, and in the highest of all forms, human hearts and blood, appeased the gods and ensured rain for their crops, healthy harvests, victory in battle, and even the daily rising of the sun. Montezuma lived in an immense palace surrounded by his 2 wives, countless concubines, and more than 500 attendants, noblemen, and emissaries. The palace complex was vast, the architecture and grounds were as sophisticated as any in medieval Europe, and the temples where the Aztec people worshipped were as impressive as the Egyptian pyramids. Montezuma's personal rooms, scented with floral perfumes, were on the upper floors overlooking his sprawling domain. He loved games and music, especially drumming, gongs, and the melodies of hand-honed flutes, sometimes accompanied by poems and singing. Majestic in carriage, with deep, piercing eyes, Montezuma wore gilded sandals and traveled by procession elevated in a litter. Ordinary Aztec citizens dared not gaze directly upon him under punishment of death. His pride, a hubris of Greek tragedy proportions, was such that he demanded to be treated as a god. By the time Cortes met the great ruler, Montezuma was the head of an immensely powerful triumvirate called the Triple Alliance, a confederation of the city-states Tenochtitlán, Texcoco, and Tacuba. These three great populaces carved a wide and powerful swath across Mexico, and, as in Europe, all subjugated peoples, no matter how far flung, were forced to pay tithes or taxes to their ruler, a circumstance that created tension and resentment among distant tribes seeking independence. At the height of Montezuma's rule, he was the supreme warlord of the most powerful military machine in the Americas, with effective dominion over some 5 million people. At the time of Cortes' arrival, the Aztecs and other peoples on the North American continent had been evolving completely isolated from the rest of the world. The discovery of the Aztecs, whom the Spaniards had previously not known to exist, has been called the most astonishing encounter in our history. The Aztecs must have had a similar response at their discovery of these alien visitors. The clash of empires that followed culminated in the bloody siege of Tenochtitlan, to this day considered the longest and costliest continuous single battle in history, with estimated casualties of 200,000 human lives. Cortes's odyssey from the West Indies into the interior of the Aztec nation remains among the most astounding military campaigns ever waged, rivaled only by the epic expeditions of Alexander the Great. In just over 2 years, using horses and cavalry techniques developed over thousands of years on the Iberian Peninsula, employing nautical warfare and remarkable military engineering, and driven by political genius and an immeasurable will to succeed, Cortes vanquished the Aztecs and their ruler, which at 15 million people was the largest empire in Mesoamerican history. For the Aztecs, the onslaught was so sudden as to be incomprehensible. No other great ancient civilization suffered such complete devastation and ruin in so short a time. The clash of these two empires is a tragic tale of conquest and defeat, of colonization and resistance, and of the remarkable and violent confluence of two empires previously unknown to each other. This confluence of cultures in 1519 is the unbelievable story of one of the greatest conquerors that history has ever known, the complex leader of the magnificent civilization he would destroy, and the cataclysmic battle that would be the end of one world and the making of a new one. Chapter 1. Setting out for New Spain and the Serendipitous Gift of Language. Hernán Cortés strode to the bow of his flagship, Santa María de la Concepción, a 100-ton vessel and the largest of his armada, and scanned the horizon for land. He had much to ponder. His navigator and chief pilot, Antonio de Alaminos, an experienced veteran who had been pilot for Columbus on his final voyage, had been in these waters before, on the Ponce de León expedition in search of the fabled Fountain of Youth, and he suggested that if they encountered foul weather, the entire fleet should make land and convene on the island of Cozumel, just east of the Yucatan Peninsula's northernmost tip. Since their hurried departure from Cuba, the fleet had been buffeted by foul weather, scattering the boats. Cortes brought up the rear, simultaneously scouring for land and for brigantines and caravels blown astray. A few, perhaps as many as 5, had been lost during the night, an inauspicious beginning to such an ambitious voyage. Cortes had staked everything he owned on this venture, in fact, more than that, for he had incurred significant debt building the ships and stocking them with provisions. His hope to get off to a good start had been slightly compromised when his patron, the fat Hidalgo Diego Velazquez, now governor of Cuba, attempted to thwart his departure, even after he had signed a contract officially confirming Cortes as captain general. Velazquez's behavior was no surprise given the contentious nature of their relationship. On his arrival in Hispaniola, the modern-day Dominican Republic, in 1504, Cortes had sought out the established countryman and worked under him, initially on a raid to suppress an Indian uprising on the island's interior, and later on an expedition captained by Panfilo de Narvaez to conquer Cuba, which they accomplished easily enough. After this successful venture, Velazquez, feeling magnanimous, gifted Cortes a large plot of land with many Indians and a number of viable, working mines on it, effectively making Cortes rich. But the two men were both obstinate, and their relationship was soon fraught with tensions that would ultimately threaten prison and even death for Cortes. Both men shared a passion for women, and a disagreement over one Catalina Suarez resulted in the governors having Cortes arrested and placed in the stocks. Cortes escaped by bribing the jailer, and Velazquez had him arrested again, even bringing a suit upon him and threatening to hang him for his refusal to marry Suarez, a snubbing that had sullied her reputation. Eventually, Velazquez calmed, and the two men smoothed over their differences. But their relationship remained volatile. At present, in mid-February 1519, Velazquez held the political upper hand, for Cortes sailed under his aegis as his emissary on a mission to trade, to find gold, and to obtain more Indians to work the mines of Cuba. But the wily Cortes had other intentions as he spotted land and had his pilot make anchor at Cozumel. Cortes's ship was the last to arrive, and on setting foot on the island, he found that the local inhabitants had fled at the arrival of the first ships, dispersing into the hills and jungle. Cortes noted their fear, filing it away as useful information. Then he was met with vexing news and a reason for the local Indians' behavior. One of his most trusted captains, Pedro de Alvarado, had arrived early, immediately raided the first village he encountered, brusquely entering temples and thieving some small gold ornaments left there as prayer offerings, and then seized a flock of about 40 turkeys that were milling around the Indians' thatch-roofed houses, even taking a few of the frightened Indians, two men and a woman, prisoner. Cortes, incensed, contemplated how to handle the situation. He needed to trust Alvarado, and he respected the fiery red-headed countryman, who also hailed from his homeland, Estremadura. Alvarado, already battle-hardened and having commanded the previous Grijalva expedition to the Yucatan, was cocksure and felt justified in making his own independent decisions. Cortes needed him and required a symbiotic relationship with his captains, but he also insisted that they obey his command, and he would tolerate no insubordination. Such behavior, he impressed upon his men, was no way to pacify a country. Cortes rebuked Alvarado by commanding his men to turn over the pilfered offerings and return them to their Indian owners. He also had Alvarado's pilot, Camacho, who had failed to obey orders to wait for Cortes at sea, chained in irons. The turkeys had been slaughtered, and some of them already eaten, so Cortes ordered that the fowl be paid for with green glass beads and small bells, which he gave to the prisoners as he released them, along with a Spanish shirt for each. Then Cortes asked for a man named Melchior, a Mayan who had been taken prisoner during an earlier expedition and converted into something of an interpreter, having been taught some Spanish by his captors. Through Melchior, Cortes spoke to the Indians as he released them and sent them back to their families, instructing them that the Spaniards came in peace and wished to do them no harm, and that Cortes, as their leader, would like to meet personally with their chiefs or caciques. The initial diplomacy worked. The next day, men, women, children, and eventually the chiefs of the villages poured forth from their hiding places in the lowland scrub and repopulated their village, which soon was bustling again. Conquistador Bernal Diaz, a soldier under Alvarado's command who had been on both the Cordoba and Grijalba expeditions, remarked that men, women, and children went about with us as if they had been friends with us all their lives. Cortes sternly reiterated that the natives must not be harmed in any way. Diaz was impressed by Cortes's leadership and style, noting that here in this island our captain began to command most energetically, and our lord so favored him that whatever he touched succeeded. The islanders brought food to the Spaniards, including loads of fresh fish, bundles of colorful and sweet tropical fruits, and hives of island honey, a delicacy that the island people nurtured and managed. The Spaniards traded beads, cutlery, bells, and other trinkets for food and low-grade gold ornaments. Relations seemed convivial, and Cortes decided to hold a muster on the beach to assess the force he had amassed in Cuba. The ships included his 100-ton flagship plus three smaller vessels displacing 70 or 80 tons. The remaining boats had open or partially covered decks with makeshift canvas roofs to provide shade from the scorching sun or shelter from the rain squalls. The bigger ships transported smaller vessels that could be lowered at ports or some distance offshore, then rowed or sailed to a landing. The ships were packed below decks with ample supplies of island fare. Maize, yucca, chilies, and robust quantities of salt pork, which had a long shelf life, plus fodder for the stock. The crew of mercenaries comprised chivalrous men bred on war and adventure. Over 500 strong, these travel-hardened packmen and swordsmen and lancers had either paid their way onto the voyage or come spurred by the promise of fortune. Cortes strode the beach and surveyed the sharpshooters, 30 accurate crossbowmen and 12 well-trained harquebusiers bearing handheld matchlocks fired from the shoulder or chest. 10 small cannons would be fired by experienced artillerymen who also carried light transportable brass cannons called falconets. The detail-oriented, highly prepared Cortes had the foresight to bring along a few blacksmiths who could repair damaged weaponry and, most important, keep the prized Spanish horses well shod. Extensive stocks of ammunition and gunpowder were packaged carefully in dry containers and guarded at all times. For land transport, Cortes brought 200 islanders from Cuba, mostly men for heavy portaging, but also a handful of women to prepare food and repair and fabricate the wool, flax, and linen doublets, jerkins, and brigandines the men wore. Cortes ordered the horses lowered from the ship's decks by means of strong leather harnesses, ropes, and pulleys, then had them led ashore to exercise and graze on the island's dense foliage. Curious islanders came forward. They had been observing the general muster, and now they were absolutely entranced by the horses, some islanders running away in fear at the sight of them, the first such creatures they had ever witnessed. Intrigued by the horse's impression on the locals, Cortes had his best cavalrymen mount the glistening and snorting animals and gallop them along the beach. Artillerymen tested cannons, firing them into the hillsides. The explosions were thunderous, flame and smoke belching from the muzzles. Archers shouldered crossbows and sent arrows whistling through the air at makeshift targets. When the smoke from the military display had cleared and the horses were put away, islanders approached the Spaniards more closely and tugged at their beards and stroked the white skin of their forearms. A few of the chiefs became animated and gesticulated aggressively using sign language and pointing beyond the easternmost tip of the island. Cortes had Melchior brought forward, and after some discussion, he reported some extraordinary news. The older chiefs claimed that years earlier, other bearded white men had come, and that two of them were still alive, held as slaves by Indians on mainland Yucatan, just a short distance, about a day's paddle across the channel waters. Cortes mused, deeply intrigued by the prospect of Spanish-speaking countrymen who had been living among mainland Indians. This was an unexpected and potentially profitable windfall. He appealed to one of the main caciques, asking him for a few of his able men whom he could send over as scouts to see what they might learn of these Spaniards and to bring them back if they could. The chief conferred with others, but they balked, explaining that they feared sending any of their own people as guides because they would quite likely be killed and sacrificed or even eaten by the mainlanders. Alarming as this fear seemed, Cortes pressed, offering more of the green glass beads that the islanders appeared to covet, and the chiefs acquiesced. Cortes dispatched several men along with his captain and friend Juan de Escalante in a brigantine. Hidden beneath the braided hair of one of the messengers was a letter stating that Cortes had arrived on Cozumel with more than 500 Spanish soldiers on a mission to explore and colonize these lands. Flanking them in support were two ships and 50 armed soldiers. While he awaited news from this reconnaissance, Cortes scouted his host's island. He noted well-built houses, orderly and neat, and other evidence of a complex civilization, including their books, elaborate series of drawings on stretched bark. What interested him most was a large pyramidal structure, a temple constructed of limestone masonry, with an open plaza or sanctuary at its top, overlooking the sea. Cortes climbed the pyramid steps and, upon reaching the temple, saw that the pavilion was spattered with the blood of decapitated quail and domesticated dogs, small fox-like canines that the people also ate. Bones were piled as offerings. Cortes and his men found these idols monstrous, even frightening. One was especially curious. It was hollow, made of baked clay and set against a limestone wall with a secret entrance at its rear, where a priest could enter and respond to worshippers' prayers, like an oracle. Around the idol, braziers burned resins, like incense. The caciques told Cortes that here they prayed for rain, and frequently their prayers were answered. Sometimes human beings were offered as sacrifice. Inflamed by the specter of human sacrifice, Cortes called for Melchior, and through him pitched his first sermon and attempt at religious conversion. Speaking to the assembled Indians, Cortes railed that there was only one God, one Creator, the one true God that the Spaniards worshipped. Bernal Diaz listened carefully, reporting that Cortes said that if they wished to be our brothers, they must throw their idols out of this temple, for they were evil and would lead them astray. These evil abominations would send their souls to hell, Cortes said, but if they exchanged their idols for his cross, their souls would be saved and their harvests would prosper. Melchior's Spanish was hardly sufficient to convincingly or accurately convey Cortes' message verbatim, especially the complex notion of the Christian soul, for which, at any rate, no Mayan terminology existed. But that did not stop Cortes from using an even more aggressive, highly symbolic tactic. The chiefs had responded that they disagreed, that their own idols and gods were good, and their ancestors had worshipped them since time began. Cortes then brazenly ordered his men to smash the idols and roll them down the pyramid steps, where they crumbled at the feet of the mystified and terrified onlookers. The islanders, even the chiefs, remained too frightened by the previous military and cavalry demonstrations to do anything other than shake their heads in terror and confusion. Cortes then supervised a cleansing, a whitewashing of the blood from the prayer pavilion. The men scrubbed away the blood smears and animal entrails with lime, and carpenters erected a wooden cross as well as a figure of the Virgin Mary. These were the new idols the people of Cozumel were to worship. Cortes then ordered the priest Juan Diaz to hold mass. On leaving the newly altered shrine, Cortes sternly instructed the caciques of the village that they must keep the altar clean and decorate it frequently with fresh flowers. As a parting gift, Cortes had his men teach the islanders how to make candles from their beeswax so that they could keep candles always burning before the figure of the Virgin. In exchange, the islanders presented Cortes with gifts of 4 fowls and 2 jars of honey. A week later, Escalante and Ordaz returned from their foray to the Yucatan. They had delivered Cortez's letter to a village chieftain, they claimed, but nothing had come of it. Cortez was disappointed, but it was time to press on, so he summoned his captains, loaded the ships, packed some Cozumel honey and wax for his king, and, as the weather looked promising, sailed away from the island paradise that they had already renamed Santa Cruz. They set their bearings for the small island called Isla Mujeres, which Francisco de Cordoba had discovered and named on his unsuccessful voyage 2 years earlier in 1517. Almost immediately, distress shouts came from Juan de Escalante's brigantine. The vessel hove to and then ignited its cannon, signaling that it was imperiled. It was leaking badly, and the pilot feared it would not make the crossing. Escalante's ship carried the bulk of the expedition's important stores of cassava bread, which had been packed in Cuba, so Cortez decided to turn around and sail back to Cozumel, where they might repair the ship in friendly environs. For several days, with the help of the islanders, Cortez's carpenters caulked the leaks. Meticulous, Cortez had his gunners clean and maintain all the weaponry, then pack and repack all the ammunition and powder. His bowmen ascertained that all the crossbows were in order and had two or three spare nuts and cords and forecords. Cortez took the opportunity to see if the Virgin Mary and cross were still affixed at the temple, which, to his pleasure, they were. The repairs complete, the stores of provisions dried and reloaded, the weaponry properly maintained, the fleet prepared to set sail once more. It was March 12th. A Sunday. Cortez requested that mass be held before they depart. That done, the expeditionary force readied to board. But just then they spotted the outline of a canoe heading toward them from the mainland, paddling furiously. The boat made land down the beach. Cortez dispatched his trusted captain Andre de Tapia to investigate. Tapia and a few officers strode down the beach, swords brandished. There they met the arrivals, a half-dozen men, naked except that their private parts were covered. Their hair was tied as woman's hair is tied, and they carried bows and arrows. Seeing the Spaniards carrying drawn swords, the oarsmen in the canoe set to push off again and flee, but a tall man standing in the prow spoke to them quietly, telling them to wait. Then he stepped forward and called out to Tapia in broken Spanish, "Brothers! Are you Christians?" Tapia nodded and sent immediately for Cortez, then embraced the man as he knelt and wept. He was a priest named Jeronimo de Aguiar, and his story was miraculous. Back in 1511, the ship Aguiar was on had struck low shoals off the coast of Jamaica, and he and about 20 other survivors had escaped in a rowboat with what little they could gather. Bereft of food and water and trading shifts on their only set of oars, they caught a westerly current and washed up on the shores of the Yucatan, half their number dead and the rest nearly so. Mayan tribesmen welcomed them by taking them prisoner, immediately sacrificing their leader, the conquistador Valdivia, and four other men, then eating these Spaniards during a festival feast. Aguiar and his remaining friends, including a man named Gonzalo Guerrero, were crammed into cages and could only watch in horror at the sacrificial ceremonies as drums rumbled into the lowland jungle and celebrants blew mournful songs on conch shells. The Spaniards were being fattened for sacrifice. Realizing their potential fate, they worked together and broke the cage slats, sneaking away into the night. Aguiar and Guerrero, along with a few others, found refuge in another village and were quickly enslaved. Aguiar became known as the White Slave. Through hard work, acquiescence, luck, and his faith, he had survived 8 years among his Mayan captors and had earned his freedom. He had received Cortez's letter from the messengers and then visited his countryman Guerrero, who was now living in a nearby village. Guerrero had won his own freedom through impressive feats of manual labor and was now an accepted member of his tribe, a warrior and a military leader. He had taken a wife, a chief's daughter, and she had borne him a daughter and two sons. His heavily muscled body was covered with tattoos, his ears were pierced, and he wore a hunk of jade in his lower lip. He had gone native and told Aguiar he had no desire to return. For his part, Aguiar had always held out the remote hope that he might someday be rescued, and from the day of his arrival on mainland Yucatan, he had kept his mind sharp and strong by counting the days. One of the first questions he asked Cortes and his men was what day of the week it was. He learned it was Sunday, and realized he was off by a few days, but by now it hardly mattered. Tucked beneath his tattered cloak was a torn old prayer book which he kept with him at all times. In his 8 years marooned, he had learned to speak Chontalmayan fluently, and he had retained much of his native Spanish, though it was rusty and came with difficulty. Cortes was elated by this stroke of providence. Through Aguiar, he could learn something of the mainlanders' customs, their beliefs and life ways. But more important, he could now communicate with them, something he understood to be crucial to his success. He immediately made Aguiar his translator and interpreter, and kept him nearby at all times. The weather was favorable, and the leaky ship had been repaired. All the weapons, horses, and provisions were in proper order. Leaving Cozumel once more, the fleet struck out for the mainland, come what may. Chapter 2. The Battle with the Tabascans and the Acquisition of La Malinche. As the fleet cut across the ocean, Cortes plied Aguiar for information about the Mayan people, trying to determine whether they would be hostile. The mainland Mayans had successfully repelled Captain Francisco de Cordoba in 1517 at Champoton, killing 20 of his force and leaving over half of his expedition, including its leader, mortally wounded. Cordoba had made it back to Cuba only to die shortly after, but he had managed to bring back gold, inflaming continued interest in the region. As Cortes paused on Isla de Mujeres to take on water and secure stores of salt, he mused on what his own reception might be like. Fair winds pushed the fleet some 400 miles around the nose of the Yucatan and into the southern reaches of the Gulf of Mexico, passing by the site of Cordoba's disaster. Cortes, patriot that he was, and certainly game for revenge, brashly considered landing there and paying the inhabitants a visit. But his pilot, Alaminos, noting unfavorable winds and also remembering the shallow reefs and shoals in the area, advised against it. They pressed on. Cortes sent Captain Alonso de Escobar, whose ship was very fast and of shallow draft, ahead to do some scouting and reconnaissance. After being temporarily blown off course, Escobar made it safely to a harbor called Puerto Deseado, where, to his amazement, a greyhound, abandoned 2 years earlier during the Grijalba expedition, came yelping and barking from the woods, her tail wagging. The dog was sleek and fattened from the abundant game in the area. When they took her hunting, she led Escobar and his men to ample supplies of rabbits and deer. Reunited, the armada moved together under full sail before favorable winds, and by March 22nd, anchored near a sandbar at the wide and tranquil mouth of the Tabasco River, renamed by the Spaniards the Rio de Grijalba, near the native settlement of Pontonchan. Because the water was too shallow for the bigger ships, Cortes assembled a force of 200 soldiers and headed into the mouth of the river in brigantines and smaller vessels, the oar boats towed by the caravels. The boats slipped slowly upriver and into dank and briny mangrove swamps. The thick canopy overhead screamed and keened with shrill bird cries. The men found the place putrid-smelling. Cortes raised his hand to his pilot when he spied dugout canoes paddling furiously toward them from upriver. Along the banks of the river, interspersed among the trees, stood hordes of Tabascan warriors armed with bows and spears, their bodies painted ochre and red, plumed in feathers. Cortes directed the bulk of his boats to a headland a safe distance away, and had cannons and falconets unloaded, while crossbowmen and harquebusiers stood ready. He hoped not to have to fight, but he would be ready nonetheless, and he entreated his men to remain at attention at all times. With Aguiar at his side, Cortes moved upriver and neared Pontonchan, a thriving commercial center, and met the first of the Tabascan warriors in their dugouts. Through Aguiar, he called out that he came in peace and wished only to trade goods for food and obtain water. That was a bit disingenuous, as he had plenty of both. He was, in fact, nosing around for gold. The Tabascans responded violently, shouting back at Cortes that the Spaniards should not attempt to land. The Tabascans warned that all would be killed if they advanced beyond a line of palm trees the Spaniards named Punta de las Palmeras, Point of Palm Trees. Cortes pondered his next move as he scanned the scene, estimating the town to possess some 25,000 inhabitants. The Spaniards were dramatically outnumbered. Cortes continued to negotiate, reiterating his desire for food and underscoring that he was perfectly happy to pay a fair price for whatever they might provide. As darkness fell, both sides stood at an impasse, though the Tabascans said that they would report to their chiefs in town and determine whether they wished to trade. They told the Spaniards to meet them in the town square in the morning. That night, sleepless on the sandy beach and anticipating battle, Cortes sent a force of 100 men to the outskirts of the village with orders to support him in a surprise attack from the flanks if a skirmish ensued. While the rest of the Spaniards lay swatting bugs and sweating in their heavy armor, the Tabascans evacuated the town of all women and children and hid them deep in the river delta forests. To thwart the Spaniards' approach, Tabascan builders erected barricades and obstructions from tree trunks and branches around the town and along the river. In the morning, the Tabascan representatives reiterated that they were unwilling to trade. Cortes and his men boarded their shallow draft warships and proceeded upriver toward the town. A throng of war-painted Tabascans lined the river, chanting, shrieking, beating drums, and blowing weird siren songs through conch shells. Standing at the prow of his boat, with Aguiar interpreting and Diego de Godoy, the king's notary, as witness, Cortes addressed the Tabascan chiefs with Spain's legally required forewarning, or requerimiento. This ironic, devious, and self-justifying speech called on the Indians to accept Christ in lieu of their own gods and the Spanish king as their sovereign. They must acquiesce to become vassals of Spain and agree to Christian preaching and education, for which they would receive untold rewards, including peace, prosperity, and everlasting life. The Tabascan response to this slick Spanish diplomacy was a rain of arrows, spears, and stones, and the first battle of Cortes' conquest was joined. Though he was a leader of men, until this moment in his career, Cortes had never commanded men in battle. Cortes was forced to think quickly. The Tabascans followed their onslaught with a full charge into the river, rushing to attack the boats and pouring forth in their own dugout canoes. Some Spanish soldiers disembarked, and they fought hand to hand with the Tabascans in waist-deep water, war clubs and spears meeting for the first time the fire-hardened Toledo steel of Spanish swords. With great difficulty and severely outnumbered, Cortes and his men managed to slash their way to land, but the riverbanks were so mucky that Cortes lost a boot as he clambered ashore, 1 foot bare. The boot was retrieved. He then commanded from the densely foliaged bank. All the while men fought, and the Tabascan warriors cried out in their language to immediately kill or capture the captain. Surrounded, the Spaniards fell into tight ranks and fought as they had been trained, in well-organized and highly regimented squads, while their enemies came at them en masse in a series of surging and retreating waves. Their organization paid off, and soon the Spaniards were tearing down and breaking through the newly constructed timber barricades and pushing the Tabascans back, the harquebusiers firing deadly balls at close range. Just then, having heard the battle joined, Alonso de Avila and his men, whom Cortes had ordered hidden the night before, made it through the palm woods and marshes in time to support, and now the Tabascans felt two-front pressure, as well as the deafening and utterly foreign explosions of cannons and falconets. They fled, retreating beyond the town to dense mangrove swamps and jungle, even still firing arrows and hand-thrown darts. The Spaniards' surprise tactic had worked perfectly, and as the last of the Tabascan warriors disappeared into the shadows, Cortes and his men convened in the village square, swords still brandished. With his royal notary Godoy at his side, Cortes strode to a great ceiba tree that stood in the central square. Raising his sword, he slashed the massive trunk symbolically three times, exclaiming before his men that he now conquered and took possession of this land in His Majesty's name. This act would have had a profound effect on the native population, for the ceiba tree was sacred, believed to be the pillar holding up the heavens themselves. Bernal Diaz, nursing an arrow wound in his thigh, recalled that he and a group of soldiers deeply loyal to Cortes replied with vigorous shouts of "Hear, hear!" supporting Cortes's taking possession in the name of His Majesty the King. Diaz added that he would aid against any challengers. But a small group of soldiers, followers of Diego Velazquez, who were still loyal to him, grumbled that Cortes had conveniently forgotten to mention Velazquez, under whose sponsorship they were supposedly operating. In a brazen move that did not go unnoticed by the Velazquez camp, Cortes disregarded them, for the first time publicly ignoring his patron. His actions had placed him directly under the auspices of the king and no one else. It was his first formal move to distance himself from Velazquez. Cortes ordered his men to rest and made an assay of his forces, determining that though a few were wounded, no Spaniard had been lost. They slept that night in the temple square, numerous sentinels posted on the perimeter, and awoke the next morning to some ominous news. During yesterday's battle, old Melchior had fled, stripping himself naked during the melee and joining the Tabascans. He left as a parting gift his Spanish clothes hanging in a tree. Cortes feared that Melchior might inform the Tabascans of the Spaniards' numbers and details of their weaponry, but he could do nothing but scowl in disgust at the interpreter's treason. Cortes wished to maintain his ship's food stores, but knew that his men needed provisions, so he sent two captains, Pedro de Alvarado and Francisco de Lugo, each with about 100 men, including specialists, musketeers, and crossbowmen, to scout the nearby countryside. They advanced in different directions into the interior. After only 3 miles, Lugo discovered a promising sign: many well-tended fields of maize, apparently irrigated and drained by means of ditches. Lugo had little time to marvel at the Tabascans' agricultural ingenuity, however, for just then, according to Bernal Diaz, they met great companies of archers and others with lances and shields, drums and standards, who immediately attacked them, surrounding them on all sides. The attack was so quick that all Lugo and his men could do was hold their shields above them to fend off a hailstorm of fire-hardened darts, stone-tipped spears, and thrown stones. The situation grim, Lugo dispatched a brave Cuban runner, who had been brought along for just such a purpose, to appeal to Cortes for reinforcement. In the meantime, Lugo organized his small force in tight ranks and had his crossbowmen, falconets, and harquebusiers fire volleys at the swarming Tabascans. Fortunately for Lugo and his men, Alvarado's drive inland had been thwarted by an impassable river crossing, and his division had arrived near the plain of Cintla. Hearing Lugo's musket fire and the enemy's war whoops and the beating of drums, Alvarado and his company sped to the battlefield. Alvarado arrived just in time to support Lugo, and together the two divisions defended themselves and repelled the onslaught as they backed into camp. They detained 3 prisoners, from whom Cortes was able to extract, through rough force, some shocking news. All the able-bodied Tabascan warriors from the vicinity would converge at the town of Cintla the next morning to make war on the intruding Spaniards. Most disconcerting of all, if the prisoner was to be believed, he claimed that these warriors numbered over 25,000, about 50 times Cortes's fighting force. They intended to surround the Spaniards and kill every last one of them. Cortes proceeded as if the main prisoner, who seemed important, a leader of some kind, was telling the truth. Then, in a move that would become one of his diplomatic trademarks, Cortes offered the prisoners gifts of green beads and released them, telling them to return to their chiefs with the message that he wished only to trade and that he came in peace. Once they were gone, he immediately prepared for war. Cortes ordered his most seriously wounded men back to the ships to recuperate. The best of his special forces, the crossbowmen, harquebusiers, lancers, swordsmen, and light gunners, prepared for action. He called for more artillery, dry powder, and 6 of the heavy cannons to be removed from the ships and transported ashore. Then, sensing that the time was right, Cortes called upon his secret weapon, the entire cavalry of 16 Spanish horses. The animals, stiff and sore from their long journey, were lowered by pulleys and led ashore. They were the first horses to set their hooves on the Mexican mainland since before the Ice Age, when the native animals became extinct in the northern hemisphere. As the sun went down, the horses were exercised and fed. The cavalrymen prepared for battle, donning heavy steel body armor, breast and back plates, plus metal tassets for their thighs and rara braces and vam braces for their arms. These they would sleep in, sweating through the humid night. The horses were fitted with breastplates of their own and small bells that jingled as they went, serving to further frighten the enemy and to alert the Spaniards to the cavalry's location. At daybreak, Cortes heard Fray Bartolomé de Olmedo, the expedition's chaplain, say Mass, then slung himself into the saddle of his dark chestnut stallion. He led his force of 500 men out of the village and on to the plain of Cintla. From the woods beyond, some 10,000 Tabascan warriors poured into the open maize fields. An equal number were strung behind in support. The well-organized warriors came in their traditional military garb and formation, some decorated in ornate feather crests, pounding drums and blowing trumpets to instill fear as they ran. Their screaming faces were streaked with white and black paints signifying rank, and they carried long bows and arrows, shields and spears, even two-handed swords like the Spaniards. The conquistadors noted that they wore quilted armor made of heavy cotton on their chests. The Spanish infantry, foot soldiers and musketeers and crossbowmen, took the initial onslaught, and many were wounded in close hand-to-hand combat. An arrow pierced one soldier through the head, and nearly 70 others were badly wounded. Cortes and the cavalry had been separated from the infantry by swamps and marshes and deep irrigation ditches that the horses could not cross, and so they were slow to arrive in support of the infantry. Meanwhile, the infantry battled wave after wave of brave warriors, using skillful sword work to repel continuous and numerically superior assaults. They fired their matchlocks, falconets, and cannons, and the whistling balls and percussive explosions drove great numbers of Tabascans out onto the open plain, where they bent to the ground and threw up dirt and grasses to conceal themselves from the Spaniards. As the smoke and dust cleared, Cortes arrived from the rear with his cavalry to find thousands of warriors regrouping on the open plain. Cortes and his cavalry charged the field, the riders wielding spears in the first mounted combat in the New World. Horse and rider galloped into the fray at great speed, charging the crowd and impaling the warriors from elevated positions. Cortes and his men speared at will, then rode and wheeled and came again, skewering and trampling the confused Tabascans. Then they would retreat to the periphery while cannon and gunfire boomed through the valley. The Indian warriors, having never before witnessed either horses or firearms, looked on in dismay as their compatriots were easily run down. They fought bravely but were no match for the killing efficiency of firearms or horses and expert riders. They fled in terror. Within a few hours, smoke hung low in the Cintla Valley, and more than 800 Tabascans lay dead in the fields. Cortes's first major military engagement on mainland Mexico had been a rout. As the last of the Tabascans scattered into the hills, Cortes and his cavalrymen dismounted, unsaddled, and tethered their horses, treating some that were wounded. He ordered rest and medical attention for his wounded men, who amounted to nearly a fifth of his fighting force, though many of the wounds were minor. One soldier reported that, "We bandaged our wounded with cloths, for this was all we had, and sealed the wounds of our horses with fat from the corpse of an Indian that we had cut up for this purpose." That night, more than 100 additional Spaniards fell ill with fevers, cramps, and general malaise, likely from foul water drunk from the streams, coupled with the oppressive heat and humidity. Miraculously, only two of Cortes's men died on the plains of Cintla, one slashed through the throat, the other succumbing to an arrow in his ear. It was March 25th, 1519, and the conquest of the Americas had begun in earnest. Cortes and his men slept armed, lest further hostilities erupt, but the night was calm and quiet. The next morning, some 30 Tabascan emissaries walked into camp dressed in finery, ornately feathered cloaks and tunics elegantly embroidered. They carried with them offerings of maize cakes, fowl, fruit, and fish. Through Aguiar, they asked to see the Spanish chief, and when Cortes came forward, they requested that they be allowed to enter the savanna unharmed to burn and bury their fallen, to prevent their stench and avoid their being eaten by jaguars and pumas. Cortes consented, with the provision that the main cacique of the village of Pontanchan come personally to discuss a treaty. Later, a lord did arrive with attendants in tow, bringing more food and offerings, including various turquoise objects and, more important, intricate masks, sculptures, and diadems fashioned in gold. Cortes noticed that the chief and his attendants seemed terrified of the horses, and the shrewd captain devised a plan to cement his dominance and get what he wanted, acquiescence and information. Realizing that these men understood neither the horses nor the fire-bursting cannons and guns, he ordered that a cannon be fired at dangerously close range. The thunderous report reverberated, and the hiss of the ball whistled past the Indians' heads and exploded foliage a great distance away. Then Cortes brought out a mare in season, followed by his meanest, most high-strung stallion. The stallion caught the scent of the mare and reared, kicked, and neighed, then pawed and stomped the ground right at the feet of the Tabascan chief. It was a devious ploy, and it worked. The chief cowered, fearing that the cannons and stallion would attack him and his people, but Cortes calmed the horse, whispering to it and soothing it. He assured the chief that, if he cooperated, no further harm would come to them from these powerful weapons. Shaken and confused, a number of chiefs held council, returning at length with more gifts, more gold, small figurines of dogs, ducks, and lizards, and at least 20 young slave women, who they said could be used for various tasks, including cooking and preparing food like maize cakes. Pleased, Cortes inquired about the gold. Did they have more? And if not, where might he find more? Where were the mines? The Tabascans assured Cortes that they had no more gold, but they pointed him to the northwest and said, "Culua, Mexico, Mexico." Cortes accepted the gifts and distributed the women among his captains, which boosted morale for the moment. One of the slave girls, whom Cortes presented to Alonso Hernandez Puerto Carrero, was a calm, confident, and precocious young woman originally from the north, in the province of Coatzacoalco. The girl had been sold to the Tabascans, who now gave her to Cortes. Her native tongue was the Mayan language of Nahuatl, but she spoke a number of other dialects as well. Her dark eyes sparkled with intelligence. Her name was Malinche. It was Palm Sunday, 1519. Cortes had his carpenters erect in the center of the Tabascan town a large cross and a sturdy pedestal to support the figures of Mary and Jesus. He thanked the Tabascan chiefs, loaded the gifts of food, gold, and the slave girls, and readied to set sail for the north. They would search for and find this place called Mexico. Chapter 3. Montezuma's Message. Under fair winds, navigator Alamino set a course to the northwest along the coast, laying tight to shore, heading toward what is now the port city of Veracruz. Cortes anchored off the port that Juan de Grijalva, on his previous expedition, had named San Juan de Ulua, first called the Isle of Sacrifices, and from his flagship's bow he surveyed the land from a safe distance offshore. The entire fleet arrived and all anchored close by, protected from strong northerly gales. Cortes ordered Spanish pennants and royal flags raised on the Santa Maria de la Concepcion while he continued to scan the shoreline and the interior for a suitable landing site and for any activity. He did not have to wait long. Before an hour had passed, Cortes spotted two large dugout pirogues paddling directly toward them. The boats contained well-decorated priests and chieftains. They halted below Cortes's ship and motioned that they wished to come aboard. Intrigued, Cortes invited them up. The conversation, however, was strained and awkward. Aguiar could not communicate with them in coastal Mayan, and Cortes grew frustrated, for he was deeply aware of the importance of communication as a tool for conquest and empire. Perturbed at the impasse, he was pondering what to do when he noticed one of the newly acquired slave girls speaking directly to the chiefs, their easy, fluid dialogue suggesting that she understood them perfectly. Cortes walked with Aguiar over to investigate and was delighted to learn that the girl spoke fluent Nahuatl, the highland Mayan tongue. She could speak to the highlanders, then translate the discourse into Mayan for Aguiar, who could relay the conversation in Spanish for Cortes. The communication proved cumbersome, but it worked, and Cortes was patient. He listened attentively, finding out what he could about these priests and chieftains. His ears perked when he discovered that they came from a place they called Mexico. Pleased, Cortes immediately elevated Malinche to interpreter and instructed her to stay always near him and Aguiar. A formal exchange of gifts ensued between the Spaniards and their visitors. The Indians offered featherwork, local cotton attire, and small trinkets in gold. The Spaniards reciprocated with food, cask wine, metal tools, and blue glass beads. It was a convivial exchange. The chiefs asked if they might have the wine to bring to their governor, a man they called Tendile, who resided some 20 miles away in a place called Cuitlaxtlan. Cortes consented, assuring the men that he came with peaceful intentions, wishing only to trade, but added that he intended to land and hoped that he might meet their leader personally if this could be arranged. The men disembarked with the wine and their other gifts, responding that soon other leaders would come to speak with him. Cortes woke at dawn the next morning, rested and invigorated. It was Good Friday, 1519. He orchestrated a landing, sending some 200 soldiers, nearly half his force, the horses and warhounds, loads of artillery, and a handful of Cuban porters ashore in the brigantines and rowboats. As nothing better was available in the near vicinity, he and his troops camped on a sloped, inhospitable sand dune amid sparse tropical palms, erecting temporary shacks for shelter and shade. The place was oppressively humid, sultry, and swarming with mosquitoes. They positioned some cannons and other artillery on the higher dunes. As was becoming his custom, and in respect for Good Friday, Cortes ordered an altar installed and mass observed. Then, sweating profusely in their armor and swatting at the insect swarms, he and his men rested and kept watch. The next morning, emissaries began to arrive at the Spaniards' makeshift camp. The first group claimed to have been sent by their leader, Cuitlalpitoc, incidentally the same man who had been sent to parley with Grijalva. And through Aguiar and Malinche, Cortes first heard utterance of the name Montezuma. This man Montezuma was said to be the magnificent and powerful ruler of the Mexica, a feared triple alliance of the city-states Tenochtitlán, Texcoco, and Tacuba, peoples who inhabited the Valley of Mexico and who have since come to be known as the Aztecs. Cortes listened carefully, receiving Cuitlalpitoc with kindness and hospitality, and assured him that he came with peaceful intentions. More ambassadors of Montezuma descended on the dune, bringing elaborate gifts, including a meticulously crafted feather garment decorated with gold rings, a war shield inlaid with opalescent mother-of-pearl, a large obsidian mirror, and large quantities of food. They said that Cortes should expect a visit soon from a very important governor of Montezuma, then left. On Easter Sunday, 1519, the ambassador Tendile arrived, as promised, with a few thousand attendants in tow, all dressed in feathered finery and elaborately embroidered cloaks, nobles carrying gifts and provisions. Perhaps for effect and as a show of religious conviction, Cortes instructed Fray Bartolomé de Olmedo to say Mass, which Tendile and his nobles listened to with great curiosity and interest. When the Spanish priest had finished, Tendile followed with a ritual of his own, as he and some other noblemen performed a dirt-eating ceremony, in which they dampened their fingers, touched them to the earth, then placed the dirt-smudged fingers to their lips in a show of respect. They handed Cortes sticks of burning incense and reeds dipped in their blood. Tendile then brought forth bearers carrying great chests, from which he proffered gifts from the great Montezuma, his emperor from high above and far away in the mountains, a deeply feared and sovereign leader who ruled from the capital city, a place called Tenochtitlán. Tendile presented Cortes with chests full of highly wrought featherwork and gleaming gold objects and jewelry. Cortes formally thanked Tendile and, by extension, his ruler, this Montezuma. He reciprocated by giving Tendile a red Spanish cap embroidered in gold depicting a mounted horseman, St. George, slaying a dragon. As a direct gift to Montezuma, he offered an intricately fashioned, inlaid, and carved Spanish armchair, upon which, Cortes said, the ruler might sit when Cortes arrived for his personal visit. This highly presumptuous and even brash suggestion was not lost on Tendile, who responded quickly, "You have only now just arrived, and already you ask to speak with our prince." His pride apparently insulted, he instructed Cortes to accept the gifts first, and then they would, in good time, discuss each other's wishes. A bit affronted himself at being addressed in this way, the clever Hernán Cortes took the opportunity to explain his situation, shrewdly fabricating some of the details and context. He told Tendile that he too served a most powerful king, one who lived across the vast seas to the east, and that his own king knew well of the great Montezuma. In fact, Cortes said, and here he laid it on thick, his monarch had dispatched him with instructions to meet personally with Montezuma and would expect nothing less. As he waited for his words to filter through Aguiar and Malinche, Cortes would have noticed the concerned expression on Tendile's face when he learned of this ruler from the east, for there existed a myth proclaiming that very thing. For the moment, though, Tendile simply nodded and spoke to one of his attendants, who was sketching furiously on a large canvas made from the dried and stretched flesh of the maguey plant. Cortes inquired about it, and Tendile informed him that this was picture writing, and that his painters were recording all the proceedings so that they could report accurately to Montezuma what they had observed and learned. Bernal Diaz remembered the moment precisely, noting that Tendile gave his painters instructions to make realistic full-length portraits of Cortes and all his captains and soldiers, also to draw the ships, sails, and horses, Doña Marina, Malinche, and Aguiar, and even two greyhounds. Cortes decided to offer a display of power to the artists and, by extension, to this ruler named Montezuma. So he ordered the cavalry to mount and ride through rigorous military exercises in full armor, their steel swords flashing in the sun. Artillerymen discharged firearms and cannons at close range. Tendile, the nobles, and the thousands of attendants shuddered in amazement and fear, marveling at the violent explosions. The disciplined artists drew their renditions of these phenomena, including smoke clouds billowing from the shot blasts that completely obliterated a nearby tree. They then turned their accurate picture-writing skills on the massive ships at anchor, vessels of a magnitude they had never before encountered, which they called water houses. Astounded by the horses and the dogs, the artists depicted these animals racing about the beach, the painting dogs rushing back and forth, their tongues dangling from their great mouths, and their fiery eyes casting off sparks. The impressive, awesome display quite literally put the fear of God in Tendile and his men, for indeed the weapons and the animals possessed such power and novelty that Tendile wondered if Cortes and these creatures might be teules, gods. Tendile then inquired about a particular helmet worn by one of the Spanish soldiers who had been performing military exercises on the beach. He asked to see it. Fabricated of metal, with a peak sloping gracefully from front to back, Tendile noted that this helmet possessed a remarkable resemblance to those worn by their war gods, including Huitzilopochtli and Quetzalcoatl. Montezuma, Tendile said, would be very interested in seeing this helmet, and he asked Cortes if he might borrow it to show his ruler. Once again, thinking on his feet, Cortes responded mischievously that Tendile could certainly take the helmet, under the condition that it be returned filled with grains of Aztec gold, which he might compare with that of his homeland in Spain, and give as a gift to his own great monarch across the eastern oceans. Of his desire and interest in Aztec gold, Cortes added that, "I and my companions suffer from a disease of the heart which can be cured only with gold." Finally, the artists having completed detailed portraits of Cortes and some of his captains, Tendile departed, assuring the captain that his people would supply the visiting Spaniards with food on the beach, and that he would soon return with a response from his ruler in Tenochtitlán. As a generous parting gift, likely on orders from Montezuma himself, Tendile had left Cortes with some 2,000 servants, workers instructed to construct hundreds more huts and shelters for the Spaniards. They also offered women to make maize cakes and cook fowl and fish, which they provided daily. Cortes was impressed with their hard work and the apparent munificence, but he was also circumspect, figuring that among these men were likely spies and informants whose charge was to report back on the nature of these visitors, their habits and weaponry and numbers. So, as he waited on the muggy promontory for Tendile's return, Cortes kept a watchful eye on the servants. Never idle, Hernán Cortes took the opportunity to get to know the beautiful Malinche, with whom he was developing something more than just good rapport. Technically, he had given her to his friend Puerto Carrero, but she had been at Cortes's side since the moment he discovered her linguistic prowess, and she would remain there for the duration of the expedition. Her talent for language acquisition was uncanny, and through Aguiar she began to learn Spanish with remarkable speed. Eventually, in her own words, she was able to tell Cortes her incredible, and in many ways sad, story. How, though she was of high birth, her chieftain father had died when she was very young, and she had been sold.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.